worship the King, all glorious above, and gratefully sing His power and His love. Our shield and defender, the Ancient of Days, pavilioned in splendor and gathered with praise.
Let's pray. Father, thank you for this beautiful afternoon. We thank you, Lord, that you have much more surpassing favor in store for us this week. In the name of Jesus Christ, we rebuke and bind every foul, wickedable spirit. We're going to go from here right now in Jesus' name, that your word may have free course in the midst of us and other people scream. Amen. We continue our study on how God is able to complete your incompletion. Now, last week, we talked about how God is able to complete your incompletion despite the ordinary you. Look at the four ladies that's been listed as the ancestors of Jesus Christ. I mean, honored to be listed in that amazing ancestry of Jesus Christ, the human ancestry of Jesus Christ. What's so special about this lady? I mean, all these ladies have not just ordinary past, they have very colorful past, and yet God used them to impact the generation of their time. One of the common denominator characteristic is that every one of them helps others fulfill their destiny. In the process, as they help others fulfill their destiny, they found their destiny. Pastor, my need, I have all kinds of challenges. Put it this way, you will see that the success of the people round about you is linked to your success. You do everything you can to make sure that the people that God placed across your path, and how many of the people that God placed above you, below you, round about you, are not there by accident. God, by divine connection, put you there. And there's a challenge, even as you fulfill their destiny, God will make sure that your destiny are being fulfilled. Now, today I want to touch on how God can complete your incompletion despite adverse circumstances and challenging situation. For that, we're going to look at some powerful truth from the story of the Exodus. You know the story of the Exodus, remember the Ten Commandments, the show you saw that Moses cried out to Pharaoh, "Let my people go." And Pharaoh would say, "No way." All right, finally, with the 10 plagues, Pharaoh was brought to his knee and let God's people go. And that is the amazing story of the Exodus. But do you know that the story of the Exodus is a beautiful picture of what Christ did for us on the cross? Jesus, when he died for us on the cross, took us out of the bondage, not just physical slavery, but slavery in every areas of our life, be it bondages to our sin or sinful habits, or bondages of poverty, bondages of sickness. God, in Christ, deliver us from all these bondages. You look at the story of Exodus, God's people receive amazing, astounding deliverance despite adverse circumstances. And, you know, when Moses said to Pharaoh, "Let my people go," Pharaoh tried every means to bring about a compromising position. First and foremost, Pharaoh said, okay, Moses, I'll let you go, but don't go very far. Let's pick up the story in Exodus chapter 8, verse 27.
"We will go 3 days' journey into the wilderness and sacrifice to the Lord our God as He will command us." So Pharaoh said, "I will let you go, only you shall not go very far away. Intercede for me."
Why do you think that the Pharaoh doesn't want? Why do you think that the devil doesn't want you to go very, very far in your worship of the Lord your God? Because the devil knows this truth. Seek ye first the kingdom of God and His righteousness, and all those things which you desire, all the flourishing things in life that you desire, all the dreams or the vision that you have will be added unto you. And He knows the truth. Delight yourself in the Lord and He will grant you the desire of your heart. Another translation say, will grant you the secret petition of your heart. In other words, the dream that you have, that you dare to think about it. You know, it's beyond your reach. You don't even dare to vocalize it. God says He will even grant those desires, the secret petition of your heart, as you delight yourself in the Lord. And The devil knows as you begin to go and worship as far as you can, as deep as you can. But the devil always will whisper in our ear, I think you've gone too far. You spent too much time in church. You've done too much thing. Come on, just be balanced. But the Bible tells in the book of Proverbs, a false balance is an abomination to the Lord. And so the devil doesn't want you to really go far in your worship. The second compromising position Pharaoh gave to Moses, okay, you can go far, but don't go with your children. You know, one of the greatest baloney today is that people come to say, Pastor, when it comes to spiritual life, you know, we got to leave our kids to make their own choice. That is the greatest baloney. Now, when it comes to the best school, we make sure we have give them the influence to go to the best school, the best university, and arrange the best tuition classes for them so they can succeed in life. How much more the spiritual life? If it is within our sphere of influence, we will do what we can to impact them to hunger for God. Because we know, even as we seek God's kingdom first and His righteousness, some of us know all these things is going to be added unto us. Now the second compromising position Pharaoh gave to Moses is, okay, fine. With all the plagues and all the pressure coming in, the heat is on Pharaoh. And Pharaoh said, Moses, you go as far as you can. You can go with your children, but don't go with your animals. Don't go with your livestock. Don't go with what you have. You know, the third compromising position the devil would bring across to you. Yeah, worship God. Go into very deep spiritual worship, 40-day fast, and become very, very spiritual. Bring your children along, but don't worship God with what you have. Don't worship God with your goods. Don't worship God with your belonging. You know why the devil doesn't want you to worship him with your belonging? Because he knows. As you acknowledge him, like what God said to Abraham, even as he acknowledged God with his tithes and offering, God says, I am your shield and your exceedingly great reward. The devil doesn't want you to be shielded from the great shaking that's going to come in waves and greater intensity in the last days. He will keep you from worshiping him with what you have. But, you know, Moses will not compromise. He said, no way, Pharaoh. We will worship God as far as we could, as much as we want, without kids, without children, without spouse, and also with our belonging. We shall worship and make sacrifices before God as He has commanded. Look at the astounding blessing they got in the video clip about the Ten Commandments.
Remember this day when the strong hand of the Lord leads you out of bondage.
Look at the passage in Psalms 105, which beautifully described the Exodus.
But he brought his people safely out of Egypt, loaded with silver and
gold.
Notice,
loaded, say loaded, man. With what? Continue.
There were no sick or feeble people among them.
Wow, no sick or feeble people. Some people say, oh, Pastor, this is prosperity gospel. Well, isn't the word of God? It says here, they came out safely, shalom. All right, they have peace, they have shalom. And they were loaded, say loaded. With what? Silver and gold, the best of Egypt can offer. And no one sick, and no one feeble. How many of us know that God wants us to bless, to be blessed in every areas of our life? Somebody says, oh, Pastor, don't you know that it's Old Testament? Yeah, you say it is Old Testament. If the old covenant, God blesses us holistically in every areas of our life, how much more? We are in a better covenant. In the book of Hebrews, the Bible tells us, we are not delivered by the blood of goats and sheep, but we are delivered by the very blood of the Son of the living God. And other people say, amen. How much more? Look at this astounding testimony in your bulletin, how God blesses. As we open to what God has for us, the first two testimony in your bulletin,
overflows in career and family. 2011 has been a year of unusual, explosive overflows in my life and family.
Overflow.
Number one, amazing promotion from department to regional position of influence and financial increase. Number two, my mom experienced supernatural healing of her leg. Wow. Thank you, Jesus. Three, my wife is pregnant with our first baby and was confirmed by the doctor during my birthday.
Oh, isn't it? I'm almost no good. Our hand is in the palm, our lives in the palm of his hand.
Thank you, Daddy God, for a birthday gift to us. Four, my relationship with my wife has grown deeper. Love her more and more each day. Five, all the above are confirmation of the much more surpassing favor for year 2012. All glory and honor to our Lord Jesus forevermore.
Wow, next one.
Praise and thanks be to God. Above all the testimonies written out, I praise and thank God for 1. My husband received a new car, fully paid, and a model above his dream.
Wow, above dream! This is astounding.
In mid-2011, I was promoted to CEO of a subsidiary, which is an extra part of my work.
I'm almost not a God to raise up even the ladies to hold key influencing positions. I'm seeing a lot of lady CEO today. And all of you people say, amen.
3. My managing director said I am to be promoted in my current position to a director. 4. My kids are doing well at school. Our dream house at RM 1 million below market value. And
well, $1 million below market value? How much is the house? I just, I don't know what house she's talking about.
And the Lord is preparing it. All glory to Jesus. Thank you, Pastor, for your messages which I cling to.
Humbleness, though, that God blesses. He wanted to bless us in every areas of our life. Then the people of God left Egypt. They came out laden, loaded with gold and silver. I'm going to share with you a couple of truths that is from the story of the Exodus and how God is going to bring us to a flourishing life in the midst of the toughest situation. Number one, you're going to speak what he says and you experience a passing favor. Look at Exodus chapter 11.
Speak now in the hearing of the people.
Speak now. Say, speak now.
And let every man ask from his neighbor and every woman from her neighbor articles of silver and articles of gold. And the Lord gave the people favor in the sight of the Egyptians.
Wow, the Lord gave that favor. What is the key to the favor? They didn't sit in the house, babying, self-pity, poor me. After so many years of slavery, nobody cared for us, nobody paid anything, just half-filled stomach. But no, they go out, they obey what Moses told them to do. They went out in faith and speak and ask the gold and the silver from their neighbors. And the Bible says, even as they speak, God releases favor. So even as I speak, God releases favor in my life. So even as I speak, God releases favor. I'm reminded that there is a direct connection between the favor increase in your life and what you speak, despite of the limitation. I mean, some of us, sometimes they say, Pastor, you don't know what I'm going through. I am limited by this guy, this big guy in the office. He is support touching me, and because of him, I don't get this increase. Limited. How many of us know that God can still bless you some other way? Pharaoh was so stubborn. He was filled with such hardened heart that he would not let the people go. And yet God releases favor upon the people to give them the gold and the silver. And how many of us know God is not limited by your limitation? Oh, Pastor, I'm limited by myself. I don't have the ability. I don't have the connection. I don't have the education. I don't have that special favor. You do have your God, who say he will give you a flourishing life. And other people say, amen. You heard the story of this lady in the banking industry that she was given a bad report, bad KPI, sabotaged by a guy. And she was naturally very depressed. She came for the entrepreneur prayer meeting. She received a word from God. Bankers shall receive the increase despite what people say. And she hold on to that word. She believed in the word. She was at rest. And she testified how God gave her an amazing bonus, an amazing increase unheard of in her entire career. Hey, how many of us though, God is not limited by your limitation. The people of God walk tall with loaded with silver and gold, because they ask, they speak what God says. But unfortunately, sometimes when we go through a difficult situation, some of us get stuck with resentment. Some of us sometimes get stuck with all kinds of negative feeling on the inside of us. And sometimes we can go into two extreme mode. On the one hand, becoming angry, become fighters, we begin to murmur, we begin to grumble, we begin to complain, like what the people of God did, all right, time of Moses. On the other extreme is that we resign to live a life of average or mediocrity. We see that display in how the people reacted to the adverse situation. Look at the passage in Exodus 14, verse 11.
Then they said to Moses, "Because there were no graves in Egypt, have you taken us away to die in the wilderness? Why have you dealt with us to bring us up out of Egypt? Is this not the word that we told you in Egypt, saying, 'Let us alone that we may serve the Egyptians'?"
You know this? They are willing to go back to slavery. They are murmuring, they are complaining. The Bible tells they murmur and complain 10 times. Continue.
"For it would have been better for us to serve the Egyptians than that we should die in the wilderness."
They rather serve as slaves. On the other hand, they are extreme. There are some people there. That we may go back to Egypt and we're going to be able to take the onions and the garlic, they're setter for onions and garlic and living a life of mediocrity instead of living with the overflow in the land of promise, a land flowing with milk and honey, with houses, big houses the giants built for them. You see, two extreme. We can either resign to live a life of mediocrity, or we become resentful, angry, and bitter. And we speak words that are not in line with God. So what happened when we speak not in line with what God says? God gave us according to our words. Look at Numbers chapter 14, verse 28.
"Now tell them this, 'As surely as I live, declares the Lord, I will do to you the very things I heard you say. You will all drop dead in this wilderness. Because you complain against me, every one of you who is 20 years or older and was included in the registration will die. Your children, however, whom you said will become and pray, I will bring them in, and they will know the land which you have rejected."
I remember that life and death, the Bible says, is in the power of the tongue. And when you speak the right word, when you speak what God says, how many of us know, we get life. Look at Proverbs chapter 11, verse 11.
"Through the blessings of the upright, a city is exalted, but by the mouth of the wicked it is destroyed."
Wow. The blessing, the positive word that you speak over even the city, maybe your job, maybe your environment, the living environment, the place where you stay. How many must know, even through the blessing of the righteous, how many must know we are the righteousness in Christ? Amen. We have His righteousness. Even as we declare and speak positive, what God says to the city, to your job, place, how many must know the city is exalted, the job environment is exalted. And how many must know that God can bless us despite what we see around about us, with all the limitation. And listen to this amazing testimony given by Pastor Vernon just towards the end of last year.
"And I will say unto my people in Malaysia, for yes, 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 I see you, I see you. And you are a great, great, great pearl, saith the Lord. So special to me, for your heart is for me, saith the Lord. And I shall do great things for thee. Don't ever think that you're forgotten and that this nation is forgotten, for I hold this nation firmly and securely in my hand and my people in my hand, and truly great blessings shall flow upon you. No matter what the situation might be, I shall take care of each and every one of thee. And not only each and every one of thee, but your family too, saith the Spirit of the Lord. For truly my blessings are upon this nation. So do not look at all the things that are going around you. Don't even speak about those things. Just speak about the great things that I have prepared for you, saith the Lord. And as you keep your eyes upon me, you shall see the manifestation shall flow free. Keep your eyes upon me and your speech upon me, and you shall truly see that the manifestation shall flow free. Free and fast, saith the Spirit of the Lord.
Notice the prophetic word says, even as we declare what God says. How many of us are God's destiny, God's design for this country? We got to be one of the economic giants of Asia. God is going to prosper this country, and we got to declare and continue to believe it. And other people say, as we speak what God says. How many of us know that God is going to bring us a flourishing life and prosper this country? And other people say, amen. Proverbs 18 verse 4.
A person's word can be like giving water. Words of true wisdom are as refreshing as a bubbling brew.
And how many of us know, words of true wisdom are as refreshing as a bubbling brook? How many of us like to have kind of overflow in your life? The key is, speak words of wisdom. And how many of us know that is God's word, speaking God's word in our life? The story of this 11-year-old boy. And I've always been told that it's not focused, it's not disciplined, and it's not going to amount to anything in life. It's not going to achieve great things in life. And one day he's supposed to give a book presentation, a book review. And as usual, it was a last minute kind of a thing. He got it from the library, didn't get a chance to finish the book. The next day, he got to give a book presentation. And he started to present. He tell an amazing, amazing story. I mean, with a lot of twists and turns and amazing details, and everybody listening to that presentation was so spellbound to what he said. They were sitting on the edge of their seats, and an amazing story. Finished the presentation, the teacher gave him a little note, A+ for the presentation. But the teacher also remarked, I actually have read that book. It has nothing to do with your story. But you're an amazing storyteller. You are creative. You're amazingly creative. You're going to achieve great things in life. That little boy was stunned. He said, nobody has spoken those words like this to him. That changed his life. You've always heard that he's not disciplined, it is not focused, and not going to do anything great in life. Those words that the teacher spoke, how many of us know that you teachers, all right, be in Sunday school, be it in the Kingdom Key classes or in the school, you have an opportunity to really impact the next generation. And that little boy today is a very successful film writer. And he always attributes his success to those words that have been given to him in a time when everybody gave him up. And friends, as fathers and mothers, it is important for us to speak vision and dreams, to speak positive words over our kids. And do you know that your children need your blessing? Go to them and say, I'm proud of you. I'm glad you are my children. You're going to do great things in life. Always lay a big vision before them. Never put down your kid and say, you're clumsy, you're dumb, you're good for nothing. How come you didn't achieve as good as your sister, the result? Never do that, because those words are very devastating to the dream that the kids have. And many people today testify that they are still today replaying those words that their mom or dad spoke over them that really destroy their dreams in the future. I heard a story of this guy who is a very successful basketball player and a good pastor. But he came from a very dysfunctional family. Dad has always been very abusive in words and hot-tempered and speak whatever that is in his mind. And he always longed for that affirmative words from his daddy. But then the daddy was caught a heart attack, was rushed to the hospital, and he was in and out of consciousness. And he came to visit his daddy. The daddy was in and out of consciousness, didn't know that it was a son. He thought it was a medical doctor. So he said to him, doctor, I wish you can talk to my son, if you can just meet my son. Doctor, I'm very extremely proud of my son. He is a successful basketball player. He is a great pastor. Doctor, I wish you could meet my son. And the guy was amazingly touched by what he heard. He keep on crying and crying and crying. He testified that those words are the single greatest impact in his life. He go on to become a very successful pastor because finally he got the word, the affirmative word that he longed for, that helped him to develop the vision and dream in his life. And of course, I don't mean to say you only talk positive words and you don't discipline your kid. I have a tape in a series on the, how to enrich your family life, and in that we have a CD on how to raise children without raising temperature. So that is a place of discipline. But a point I bring up to you is this. Speak what you want to see and not what you see. You know, I heard the story of this couple that a kid that come out of Sunday school, and this couple is a really committed believer, but the kid has gone astray. You know, let me put it this way. Even if you try your best, sometimes your kids can also go astray. And God is the best parent, but Adam gone astray. All right? And key thing is, don't be filled with guilt and condemnation when your child has gone astray, because they are exposed to influences that are beyond your control. And this is what happened to this guy. He mixed with the wrong crowd of people and got the wrong influence, got into drugs and all kinds of vices. But the couple never gave up on their children. They never talk with resentment. They never complain. They never murmur. It exerted an emotional toll in their life, but they keep on speaking. But God says, me and my household shall serve the Lord. And they keep on saying, the seeds of the righteous shall be mighty in the land. My child will fulfill his destiny. My child shall do big things in life and impact the world. One day, that child got an astounding breakthrough, and God began to work in his life. He came back to the church, came back to the family, finished school, finished college. Today, he volunteered in the church, helping kids that are going through the same situation. And how many must know that the key thing is to keep speaking what God says. Next point, speak what he says and you create new vision and new beginning. You see, in Exodus chapter 14, how in the midst of the tough situation, Moses continued to bring positive word, encouraging word, words that create fresh vision to the people of God. Exodus 14 verse 13.
And Moses said to the people, do not be afraid. Stand still and see the salvation of the Lord, which he will accomplish for you today. But the Egyptians whom you see today, you shall see them no more forever.
How many must know? The enemy which you see today shall be no more tomorrow and forevermore. And other people say, so the enemy I see today, the enemy I see today will be no more tomorrow. It could be an obstacle. It could be somebody big in the office that decides to sabotage you, to try to do all kind of unethical things against you. It could be a competitor, a business competitor. It could be unfavorable policy in your workplace. But how many of us know the enemy, which is so big in front of you today, shall be no more as you continue to speak what God says and other people say? Amen. Verse 14.
The Lord will fight for you and you only need to be still.
You know this, Moses is speaking life-giving, vision-creating words to his people. That's exactly what God did in Romans chapter 4 verse 17.
The God who gives life to the dead and calls things that are not as though they were.
That's how God created this world. When he created this world, there was darkness. I don't know why. We don't know why. Theologians say that it was a description of the fall of Satan. When God looked at the darkness, he said, oh man, so dark. Whoa. I don't want to be God anymore. I resign as God. Did God say that in the midst of darkness? No. He looked at the darkness and he said, let there be light. And there was what? Light. In other words, how many of us, when you speak God's word, it's like seeds that create fresh vision, fresh dream, new beginning in our life, in the midst of hopelessness. You know, Jesus talked about the parable of the sower and the seeds. And why do you think that Jesus used seeds to describe the Word of God? Because Jesus knows the tremendous latent power of seeds. All right, this is the reason why I'm excited about the invention, the iPods, you know, the podcast. All right, it is not just for hearing music. It is because the seeds of God's Word is going to create fresh vision, fresh dream, as we keep listening and listening to what God says. It's amazing. They found a seed in Pharaoh's tomb. Dated. Carbon dating, 2,000 years old. They planted it and it started to germinate. You know, sometimes we get a seed. Sometimes we hear the word very boring. It seems lifeless. Those seeds seems lifeless. Those seeds in the dark for 2,000 years, but they've been planted, brought with the proper water, and now the right sunshine, it bursts forth with life, and other people say, amen. Wonderful Jesus. You know, today many people, they don't have vision. They don't have dreams. They don't have directions in their life because nobody spoke words of faith into them. Nobody released seeds, the seed of God's word into them. And because of that, they felt they don't have the ability, they don't have what it takes to fulfill their greatest potential. They feel small. They feel they're not going to amount to anything in life. How many of us know God says, we are the people that are going to impact them with the vision, with the seeds of God's word, and other people say, amen. In 1974, I heard the story of this young boy came out of college, and he was feeling very miserable, very confused in life. He didn't know what God wants him to do. He was loitering around in his mother's saloon. And, didn't know what to do, just loitering around. It's like just buying time. And one day, in that saloon, was a lady named Ruth. She came in to dress her hair. And all of a sudden, he looked at that young boy. He stared. How many times did he stare at? Look at this young boy and stared at him a long, long time. And all of a sudden, he cried out, put down that dryer. Somebody bring me a pen. Somebody bring me a piece of paper. I got to put down what God is bursting in my heart for this young boy. So he wrote down what she felt God is saying to the young boy. He said, young man, son, you're going to do amazing thing in life. You're going to travel the world. You're going to impact thousands of people. You're going to achieve great things because God has great things in store for you. Today, 37 years later, Denzel Washington still carry that piece of paper in his wallet. Every time he go through a discouraging situation, he will read that particular word that ignited something on the inside of him that changed him, to give him fresh vision in the midst of confusion. And today, Denzel Washington is an amazing actor and film producer, and many awards that he got, Grammy Awards and Academy Awards and Golden Globe Awards, and he always attributed his success today to those words that he received 37 years ago, and other people say. And Jesus does it all the time. He looked at a bunch of very rugged fishermen, like Peter, always say the wrong word at the wrong time, impetuous. Look at Matthew, tax collector, reputed to be a very corrupted one. And look at Thomas, who would not believe until he plunged his finger through the palm of Jesus' hand. He looked at a bunch of very ordinary, very crude, rude, bunch of mediocre, ordinary person. He looked at them in the eye and said, you are the light of the world. People that laugh at them, and Jesus, are you joking? But you see, Jesus said, a city standing on a hill cannot be hidden. How many of us know that God's destiny for your life, what God has spoken in your life, cannot be hidden? There is nothing that can limit you to what God has in store for you. And other people say, amen. Hallelujah. Give God a hand. Hallelujah. Praise God. I had a story of Tommy Bennett. We went there several years ago. I brought in a bunch of people there to go to one of their pastors' conferences. And the thing we learned from this senior men of God, Tommy Bernard, and one of them, we came back, we have a fashion show. How do you remember that? Evangelistic fashion show, of course. And almost anything that really impressed me is the way that their staff responded to what they say. One time he stood up and said, we're going to feed 10,000 poor people in our church, all right, in our community. And the queuing time for each of those who are going to take the food is not more than 7 minutes. I'm amazed by the way that the staff responded to him. They didn't rise up with resentment. Who do you think he is? A big bully wanting us to do all that kind of thing. Don't you think the grassroots level is not practical? It's impossible. 10,000 people and they queue less than 7 minutes. Impossible. I'm going to stand up against him. I'm going to speak to him. I'm going to tell him off. No, the staff didn't do that. All right, they have a spirit of accent. They don't know what their boss say. They take it as a mandate from God. They take it as a word from God. They come together and they pray. And God gave them the creativity to be able to feed 10,000 people, each of the queue, and in not just 7 minutes, within 6 minutes. How many members say, rise up to what God has mandated them. And other people say, and his son, Matthew Barnett, went with that same kind of a spirit of excellence. He believed he can do what God calls him to do. He went over to Los Angeles to start the Dream Center. A very unique ministry. Now, we heard of people like Mother Teresa reaching out to the poorest of the poor. And different church have different ministry. We cannot copy, right? And it was this Tommy Barnett's son, Matthew Barnett, felt the call of God to reach out to the roughest of the rough people in Los Angeles. He would go to a drug dealer boss and said, you're going to be my zone pastor. And he would go to the prostitute in the street, he's still advertising her staff, and said, you're going to be my song leader. He would go to the gang leader, the kill people like nothing, and said, you are going to be my prayer partner. If you look at this young punk, Matthew Barnett, lost his mind. But over time, one by one, they became what he said concerning them. He was calling those things that were not as though they were. He didn't look at the person and call him as it is. Anybody, everyone can do that. Anyone can look at a prostitute and say, you're a prostitute. Anyone can look at a drug dealer and say, you're going to be finished, you're going to go to hell. Anyone can say that. It takes a man of faith, a man of excellence. Look at people like them and say, God is able to call you to be what God calls you to be. And other people say, amen. Hallelujah. Wonderful Jesus. You know, I learned one thing, that people rise up to become what you affirm them to be. Heard the story of this principal of a high school. He called together three teachers. And that you are the three top teachers in the whole California state. Three top teachers. I want you to teach, I'm going to bring together 300 top students. These are the brightest, highest IQ, the most creative, the brightest in the whole state of California. You're going to train them, teach them for 3 months and see what you can bring out of them. So 3 months later, the three top teachers came to the principal and so happy and beaming with joy. Sir, do you know that these 300 top students have go beyond 30%, beyond the top average of the country? 30% above the top average. The principal looked at them and said, great. But I want to tell you, let you know that this is actually an experiment. The 300 students that you have, actually not the top student. They are average students. Just normal student, randomly taken and chosen. Wow, the three teachers are so happy because they're able to take 300 average students to become top students. Not only that, 30% achievement more than the top average of the country. The men just were about to go off and the principal pat them on the back and said, by the way, you are not the three top teachers. You are just randomly chosen out of the average. Hey, how many must know? People live up to the level of what you expect them to be and affirm them to be. Now, friends, if it can happen in the secular world, how much more in the spiritual realm? And how do people say? Yesterday, I look at the young people, your young people. I look at them in the eye and say, God is going to use you guys, as a you, young people, you to impact this world and impact this nation. You, I told the young people, you are going to be the next leader in every faculty, be it in the area of business, be it in the area of banking and entrepreneurial skills, be it in the area of medical discovery, be it in the area of computer knowledge and technical skills and engineering skill. You are going to be the leader. You're going to be the head, not the tail, in this country, in the world. And I told them, I'm not surprised if one of you could find a cure for cancer. I'm not surprised if one of you could find an answer to AIDS. Every one of them, eye wide open. Pastor, you're trying to encourage us, huh? So no. Already happening. We have an amazing testimony a couple of years ago. Elaine, I still remember when we started the Bible and Youth Service, she was sitting right at the second row. Often the second seat. And every time the word of God is being preached, she would open her eye wide and listen to every word that comes out of. And Elaine beat many other European young scientists. That point in time, she was completing her PhD degree. And she did studies in gynecological sciences, found something that could be a cure for cancer. And she was making the presentation in Florence and many other cities in the European Union. Take a look at this picture that is brought out by the Stars magazine. The young scientist that beat so many other European. And how we must know that God is raising up special, special people in our country. And all the people say, amen. I said, you're going to be the next Steve Wonders. Yeah, you could be the next Billy Graham, Steve Jobs, okay. Who's Steve Wonder? Wondering who is Steve Wonder? Steve Jobs, la! It's amazing. Young people, they have the technological know-how that we are still trying to catch up, like Facebook, all kind of stuff, you know, the iPod and other. We are still trying to catch up with them. Today's knowledge, the book of Daniel tells us the last day, knowledge is on the increase. And how many must know the increase is there? Because God wants to put His people on the head, not the tail. And other people say, how many must know? God is placing us in this amazing, astounding century. God didn't choose Esther to live in our decade. God didn't put Moses to live in our time. God put us, you and me, in this century, because how many must know God going to use us to impact this world? And other people say, amen. And I told them, you're not anybody. You're a child of the Most High God. That means you have God's gene. So the person on the right, you have God's DNA. Pastor, what is that? The oxyribonucleic acid. You have God's nature. You have seeds of greatness on the inside of you. And other people say, amen. God's going to use you to do astounding things. But you need to speak what God say. Pastor, I'm an elderly man. I'm not young. Well, the Bible said in Acts of the Apostle, young men shall see visions. Old men shall dream dreams. And other people say, Pastor, I don't have dream. Now, the word dream, I don't think merely literally refers to sleeping dream. I believe God says, oh man, even as they dream, even as they rest, say rest, they shall see amazing, amazing visions. The reason why sometimes as we grow older, we're not seeing much of visions and possibility. Number one, we experience all those disappointing situations. We get discouraged. Hey, remember, just because there is failures in the past, it does not mean now you are going to fail, because right now you have God's seeds of greatness on the inside of you. And other people say, amen. Amen. So, old men, I'm talking about myself also. I'm not young. Well, I'm young. Okay. I'm only 33 years of age. Hey, remember this. Don't allow the bitter situation of your life limit what God wants you to do today. You know, as you grew older, you allowed the logics to come in and all the cannots and all the impossibility. I admire the staff of Tommy Bennett when they say, we shall feed 10,000 people within 7 minutes. They didn't rise up and rebuke their boss and tell him off. No, they went to God. Say, God, you give a mandate through our pastor, give us the wisdom to do it, and they go beyond. They feed the poor within 6 minutes. And other people say, amen. The key is, Hamra must know, we got to speak what God says. And the reason we can have confidence that God is going to bring us a flourishing ending is because Jesus paid the highest price for our success. He died for us. You recall the first drop of blood that Christ shed was in the Garden of Gethsemane. God wants to touch the business world first. God wants to touch your field. God wants to touch your occupation where you toil, where you work, that even as you rest, that the old man sleeping, they could have dreams. And other people say, amen. God going to use the young and the old, and other people scream, amen. Amen. I remember that we can have great confidence to have a flourishing life, abundant life, because it's sealed by the blood. Even as in the Exodus, people came out loaded with silver and gold, none of them sick, none of them fever, because blood was sprinkled upon the doorpost. How much more with a better covenant, not with the blood of goats and sheep, but the blood of the precious Son of God, sealed with His blood, that we can have blessing in every area of our life. Father, we ask that you bless this bread, bless this wine, that we can discern the body of Christ, not just merely as a symbol, but the very bread of life. Bring us life, because it's your very body and your very blood that we are partaking even right now with faith. The Lord Jesus Christ said, take and eat, this is my body given for you. The Lord Jesus Christ said, this cup is a new covenant in my blood, pour out for you for the forgiveness of all your sins. Let it close with an opportunity for those who have not made Jesus Christ the Lord of your life to receive Him. The rest of you can join me in this prayer. Heavenly Father, thank you for sending your Son Jesus Christ to die for me on the cross. Because of Him, I can have a flourishing life. We are confident of a flourishing finish. In the midst of the tougher situation, even as we speak your word and act out what your word says, you will bless us in an amazing, surpassing way, surpassing favor. Release in Jesus' name that surely you're going to astound the world with the blessing that we enjoy. And all the people say, amen. Amen.